Welcome to it. It's the Daily Caller podcast for the 25th day of October 2019. I am Derek Hunter. I am your Mr. Rourke. I am your host for this wonderful podcast. And as we do every single Friday, we do an interview with somebody who has something interesting to say. And this week is no different. Our guest today is author of the new book, The War on History, The Conspiracy to Rewrite America's Past. It's Jarrett Stepman, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations on the book. I have, having done this, it's different now. When I had kids, I got a lot more sympathy for somebody who had kids. I had no sympathy before I had kids. After I wrote a book, I had a lot more sympathy because there's a lot of similarities in the birthing process. So I want to ask you a little bit about the process of the book before we get into the substance
Absolutely.
Of the book. Where the rewriting of history is all around us. What caused you, was there a particular moment or event or series of events that made you say, all right, I got to do something about this?
Yeah, it really was a lead up. I've been kind of writing about this topic for a few years, kind of the attacks on American historical figures, statues, things like that. Of course, the Charlottesville incident really threw this into overdrive, I think, where you saw a rapid pace. I think it started out with especially the Confederate statues. You had that debate and very quickly moved on to other things. And because I've written a lot about American history, first principles, I thought, you know, I need this. This is a time to write a both explain to people what this war on history is about, because I think there are a lot of people saying, well, why are these people attacking statues? Why are they going after historical figures? And then going back and making that defense of American history. You know, we have a lot to be proud of in this
right.
country. And I explained, this is why you have a reason to be proud as Americans of your history.
It's kind of funny. I was working in Baltimore at the time when the day the statues disappeared, the four statues. And believe it or not, murders continued in the city after the removal of statues. I was personally shocked. I thought they'd solved all of their problems. They can't do anything right. They can't do anything quickly except issue parking tickets and remove statues. But there was that furor over that. And it stemmed from Charlottesville, but it was kind of going on before that, where there were pushes here and there to rename schools, to rename roads and counties or whatever. Can you think, was there a particular time, 20, 30 years ago, maybe even more, when this started? Where was the first snowflake that became the avalanche?
You know, it's funny, especially one of the figures that I talk about in my book is Christopher Columbus. Mm. And Columbus has actually been under attack a little longer. He was really featured in A People's History of the United States, written by Howard Zinn, 1980.
Horrible person.
Really took a hatchet to Columbus. And I grew up in the San Francisco Bay Area. And a lot of this stuff was happening before it was happening around the country. 1992, you had big Columbus Day around the country. Berkeley, of course, changes it to Indigenous Peoples Day, which at the time people kind of, okay, you know, Berkeley, they're crazy, whatever. People still love Columbus. He's an American hero. We can all celebrate. But it's really ramped up since that time. I mean, this year, I think, was quite incredible. We had here in the District of Columbia, I mean, this is the city named after Columbus, where they held an emergency session of the D.C. City Council. An emergency.
I know. I love that it was an emergency piece of legislation. Like, we've got to do something now.
Right now. You know, murders are up this last year, but we've got to do something now to change this. And look, you've had counties all over the country changing names, taking down statues. In New York, you had this commission that was targeting Columbus statues for removal. You know, that's a really fast pace. And I think we are seeing the fruits. I mean, you can see the kind of acolytes of Howard Zinn today who, look, if you ask a younger American today, what do you think of Christopher Columbus? You ask somebody who may be in school right now, say, oh, I know he's a bad guy. And that's about all they know. And they're getting that from their schools. And look, that kind of indoctrination has happened for a long time. We're seeing the fruits of that now, and we're looking at one historical figure after another having to go.
Let's start with Columbus, because you do write about him in your book, and you were on my wife's radio show in D.C. here last year talking about this. And every year it seems ready-made for this, and they just find a way to go crazier. The left acts as though nobody would have discovered that the world had another half to it. And, you know, it wasn't like Christopher Columbus brought over jars of diseases and just flung them out to the natives. Human beings in Europe, in the Western, in the Eastern Hemisphere, the other hemisphere, had diseases that they'd had, and then over here had diseases that they'd had, and neither side had a particular immunity to either one of them. So a lot of the so-called genocide that was, it was accidental, but it's ascribed as though Columbus was like picking crew members based on how sick they were so that they could come over and infect the natives.
You know, it really is incredible. And they do pin that on Columbus. And it's amazing. I mean, we talk, and that is most of the destruction that happened in the New World was because of disease. Something that, believe me, Christopher Columbus had no concept of what disease actually was.
Right.
And a lot of those diseases did spread back and forth from the, I mean, that's what happens when you have populations that have been separated sometimes by thousands of years. I mean, you do have the spread of disease like that. I have to remind people, I mean, especially because of the fruits of what Columbus did led to the creation of many countries in the New World. I mean, we think about, you know, Western civilization was brought to the New World. We think about modern medicine, which is very modern. I mean, a lot of these diseases weren't even identified until the late 19th, early 20th century. And to a certain extent, that's the fruit of Columbus going across the water and discovering this New World. We wouldn't even have any concept of these diseases if it wasn't for that. And so this idea that this is Columbus's fault and that everything that happened in the New World after should be blamed on him, it's a bad mentality. I think that is a lot of these attacks that have happened on Columbus, because they simply see it as, look, America just really shouldn't have existed, period. Mm. I think that's really where this is coming from.
That's the root of this is a dislike of this country. I don't know that it's necessarily this country, the geography of it, but it's what this country represents. It's the last bastion of true liberty where it doesn't matter where you were born. Where you were born has no bearing on where you end up in life. Everything you do in between those times does. And that is essentially the antithesis of socialism, which is really their end game and their desire. But Columbus, why does Columbus still, because I get the activists. I get it. That's what they do. And they're ready to be outraged. They have a hair trigger and they want it. They need to be outraged over something. But then there are so many people that, especially younger college and high school students, are susceptible to it. Not just the, well, he was a bad guy, but the, he was a bad guy, we must take to the streets, we must rip this down, we must change this. Where does the radicalization ramp up come from? Because it seems so much easier now.
Yeah, you know, I think it's because these activists, they are acting as sort of the moral authority. I mean, we talk about, especially this is ramped up, you talk about cancel culture and things like that. You find one bad thing about somebody, destroy them, get rid of them, literally wipe them from existence, wipe all memory of them. And I think that's really what they're trying to apply to history. A lot of these activists, look, I don't think most people in this country are like most of the activists who go and tear down statues and throw things at them. There's a small minority. But those people do act as kind of moral arbiters in this thing. And nobody, of course, you say, well, do you want to support this guy who's this horrible racist? You say, no, of course, I'm not a racist. And you say, well, if you support Christopher Columbus, you must be a racist. And people, I think they're afraid. And a lot of them don't know simply what the historical record is. You know, you're approached by somebody who is a left-wing activist. They've read A People's History of the United States. They throw things out that sound like, oh, this person must know the truth. This sounds pretty serious. So they back away. And I think it's a combination of very engaged activists plus a lot of Americans who are afraid to kind of take that stand. I mean, do you really want to be associated with people say, oh, you're a racist for defending Columbus or these statues? People don't want to be associated with that, and they get afraid, and they back down when they really shouldn't. They should take a step back and say, you know, why is it that in our nation's capital, we have a giant statue of Christopher Columbus at Columbus Circle? Maybe there's a reason why the founding fathers thought that they should honor Christopher Columbus. There's a reason why generations of Americans did. Instead, take a step back and say, these are the reason these things are here. This is the reason why Americans once celebrated these things. Instead of taking these things down and being afraid to defend them, learn more about these people. Learn more about their legacy. It's the great legacy of our country. Do we really believe we live in a great country? I think there are a lot of people who say yes, but there are many more today that say no. I don't think America's
ever great.
I can
think of a political party that is predicated on the answer being no. Talk a little bit about Howard Zinn, because I think there's 35, 40 years old, if you're over that, you don't know who Howard Zinn is, odds are. And if you are under that, you might not understand the bastardization of American history that he did, because he's probably taught to you as straight history. Tell us who he is, how he got to be so prominent, and why what he did was so bad. I'll just tone it down to bad.
Well, it was insidious what he did. In his book, A People's History of the United States, which I believe was published in 1980, Howard Zinn was a far-left guy. I mean, he was a member of the Communist Party. He wrote this book called The People's History of the United States, which at the time was not taken all that seriously. Even by the academic left at the time just saw him as kind of a radical. He has a political agenda. A lot of his writings, especially about figures like Christopher Columbus, were coming straight from Marx and Engels. I mean, that's his narrative about Columbus, is that Columbus brought capitalism in this globalized world. And that's where he gets his history straight from. He used a lot of references in his book that are inaccurate or seemingly came out of the blue. He references himself. It's not very good history, but it's good ideological history. Mm-hmm. It's a very neat picture of America as a tale of oppressors and oppressed. You're either part of the oppressor groups or you're part of the oppressed. And it's a very powerful narrative. I mean, and it feeds certainly into, you could say, the identity politics of today very, very neatly. And so his histories really took off. And there's something called the Howard Zinn Project, which pushed this curriculum in a lot of high schools across the country. I believe his book is now the most used textbook in a lot of schools across our country, which is quite frightening. And you can see why a lot of young Americans come out of that with a very skewed view of what our history is about.
But in popular culture, though, people like Matt Damon and Oliver Stone have embraced Howard Zinn.
They really have. It's really incredible the kind of – look, at one time, this was a fringe character. And look how fast the fringe became the norm. And I have to say, especially for younger generations, his histories have become the norm. I think that would have seemed wild, even to a lot of the liberal professors of the past. And frankly, it's up to us to undo this. It's really terrible. Unfortunately, a lot of our public schools have bought into this, and you're getting parents who say, hey, my kids, they're learning this stuff, and I don't know what to do. You know, it's one of the reasons why I support school choice so much, which is an issue that my wife works on. Because, look, this is what you get when you go to school. I got this when I was going to a public school in the San Francisco Bay Area. My parents pulled me out of that school. I remember the day my father, it was June 6, 1994, my father asked, what did you learn in class today? And I said, well, nothing, writing these letters. He says, you didn't learn anything about the anniversary of D-Day. This is one of the most important days in human history. And so my father actually confronted the teacher and said, why haven't you taught my son about American history? You're not teaching him about civics and what it is to be an American. The teacher was very confused. So we had to write these letters and stuff. He says, well, you know, why don't you have them write a letter to one of the people who's there on that day and try to convey to these students, you're an American. This is what happened. This is your history. You should be proud of it. You know, dad said, hey, you know, my kid's not coming back to the school next year. And, you know, my parents put me in a private school. I think for a lot of parents, it is important to take these stands and defend American history and civics. And look, if you've got to pull your kid out of school, if you have to homeschool, if you have to send your kid to a private school, you know, that needs to be an option. So, and you know, a lot of this stuff was happening. It was starting in the 80s and 90s. Our generation has borne fruit, and it's even worse today.
Along the lines of what you just said about your own personal story, those 1994 D-Day, obviously your parents were very involved in your education and noted it just happened very coincidentally be on that day that question was asked. But what red flags would you say are out there that parents who, you know, help their kids with their math homework, but history is reading, maybe that's, you know, reading and writing is more important in the hierarchy of getting your learn on. So what should parents look for as far as a red flag that maybe, just maybe, that their children are getting a bastardized version of history?
Well, it's funny. You just brought up math and science, and you would think that those subjects would
also be away.
We just had the story, of course, recently with Seattle introducing woke math, in which they're introducing a kind of ethnic studies into math, in which they teach students that Western civilization math is a bad thing and that you're oppressed, which is incredible.
That wasn't the end game.
Right.
Though. You know, that wasn't the start point. There was a start point where they introduce it. You know, your first cigarette is far different than your 200th cigarette, and by then you're hooked. But the first one, you got a chance to make a difference. Your second one, maybe. Where's the gateway drug, if you will?
Well, it does come in history and social studies courses. And I do urge, especially parents, to be very aware of what your child is learning in school and be informed yourself. If your kid does come home, be able to talk to them about American history, to be able to educate them. Use the 4th of July to say, hey, look, this is what America's built on. Have them read the Declaration of Independence. Have these small things that reinforce to your kid, because even if they go into an environment in which they're getting people who are saying many things that are different, the teachers, maybe they're using a People's History of the United States, they're using this text, you can at least give your child enough of an education so that they can think for themselves and say, you know, what I heard about Columbus in my class doesn't conform to what I've read elsewhere. I think this is wrong. You know, have some faith also in your children to educate them and inform them so that when they're talking to their friends and their peers, they say, well, no, actually, I've read that Columbus wasn't such a bad guy. The founding fathers were really great. They really did mean all men are created equal.
And there goes the GPA as soon as this kid starts doing. One of the things you write about is a tradition that's coming up, Thanksgiving. It's a feast. It's a time for family and to watch. I'm from Detroit, to watch the Detroit Lions lose to whoever they happen to be playing on that day. And most importantly, it's the day before Black Friday when you get up at 3 a.m. and kick old ladies to buy a cheap TV. But Thanksgiving it should be celebrated. It's a time when the natives in this country helped in a very important time, in a time of need. The settlers weren't Americans then. Now that is, again, as everything is, including the time of day, is now racist.
Yeah, it's really incredible. I'm sure this year we will see the series of op-eds and Salon and Slate saying that, well, really, the pilgrims were bad. And you have, and really something I think it's pernicious that I've seen these things. You have nothing really to be thankful for this Thanksgiving.
A good rule of thumb for history is anybody who has buckles on their shoes is bad. Yeah. That's just science. That's not me.
And I go back and defend the pilgrims and the Puritans. I mean, you know, really this concept, I mean, people hear this idea of this shining city on a hill. And this came straight from a speech by John Winthrop when he crossed the ocean. He wrote this speech on Christian charity, which is kind of a foundational. Again, America, United States did not exist, but the seeds of what we would become were beginning right there with the Puritans and the pilgrims. I think that day, Thanksgiving, was set aside. And it's actually very much a 19th century holiday. This woman named Sarah Hale, who wrote Mary Had a Little Lamb and things like that, actually advocated that Lincoln that Lincoln create a national holiday of Thanksgiving. And it really took off, especially during the Civil War, which Americans wanted to look back and be thankful for the fact that they even had a country at that point. So it is an important American cultural holiday that has brought in immigrants, that has brought in Americans of all different backgrounds. It's sad to see, especially on the far left, people attacking that legacy and that tradition, because it's one of the few things that really binds us as a country these days. I mean, Thanksgiving is one of those holidays that people all across this country really feel like they can celebrate. And it's a wonderful holiday. You give thanks for the things that you have in this life. And I think that's a message I try to convey in my book, too. You know, you should be thankful for the things that our country has given us. I mean, the world is full of tyranny. It's full of oppression. It's full of a lot of bad things. The fact that we have something here that's a little bit nice is nearly a miracle. And I think that people should be thankful for that.
Absolutely. Now, let's talk about the people that helped us get that. You alluded to the founding fathers earlier. Obviously, the founding fathers are just a bunch of slave-owning white racists who probably raped women. And again, this is what people are being taught, as absurd as that is. This standard, this idea of judging the past by the standards of the present, the ever-changing, conveniently malleable standards of the present, is designed, I think, mostly to smear the character of the founding fathers. Of course they were imperfect beings. It was an imperfect time. We're imperfect beings. It's an imperfect time. We are trying to establish a more perfect union, not a perfect union, because the founding fathers were smart enough to recognize that we are not perfect and never will get there, but we should always be moving towards that, whereas today's revisionists seem to believe that we are perfect now.
And they do, or they think that by severing us from this history that they can create a more perfect future. I think that's a big part of their outlook. And it's really incredible, especially the attacks on the founding fathers. And I have a chapter on Thomas Jefferson in particular, because he's come under a lot of attacks recently for being a hypocrite.
Raping Sally Hemings. Yeah,
exactly. He's a rapist. He's a hypocrite. He really didn't believe those words. He said that all men are created equal. And people attack him for that. And I do wonder, you know, these people are attacking him. Thomas Jefferson spoke those words in the Declaration, wrote those words in the Declaration of Independence, a time in which slavery was very much a reality in the world. I mean,
there was very little dissent
from even these concepts. The standard by which we're judging them is the one that they set. And they were the ones who were brave enough in a time in which this was ubiquitous to say, no, this is actually something that's wrong that needs to be done away with, and became, of course, the inspiration for its eventual abolition at the end of the Civil War, something that, you know, obviously President Abraham Lincoln, who gave all credit to Thomas Jefferson for adding those words to the Declaration of Independence. I think that's an incredibly important thing to remember. And look, if we're going to judge these people as imperfect or fundamentally wrong, I mean, we're going to have a lot of empty pedestals, including our own generation for sure.
Well, Tupac and Biggie busts, I think, will replace the founding fathers quite nicely. Where does it, along that line, where does it end? Where does it go? What happens to a society that whitewashes, its own history? Because nobody was saying, George Washington could not tell a lie, he chopped down a territory and confessed to it, all of that sort of old wives' tale, the urban legend. But nobody really had delusion that our founding fathers were perfect beings, that they couldn't take baths because they floated on water. They were human beings. Yet by only focusing on the negative, in an attempt to remove the reverence, the rightful reverence for them, it strips the country in a lot of ways of an important parts of our identity. What are the end results of that, the long term, on the society that you're ripping out the roots of?
You end up a society with no past and no future. I think that's a big part of it. And I think especially in a country like the United States, which is a massive, very diverse country, you know, we have always been bound by our shared history. This is something that one time used to be shared, look, right and left, liberal, conservative. You could say, well, at least, you know, we all respect the founders, respect what we are as a country. We have differences over policy, but we have this shared tradition. And splitting that tradition and tearing it apart leads us to the future where ultimately people are boiled down to their ethnic identities. They're boiled down to, which I think is a large part of this process. And so we have no shared history. We don't understand even how to confront the things, the challenges we have in our own time, because we have no idea how these things were faced by people in the past who may have faced the same things. You know, how do we face our own moral dilemmas? It all seems very clear looking back. You could say, well, of course slavery should have been abolished. But how did we get to that point? What were the decisions these people made? How do you understand human nature if you don't know how human beings were 150 years ago? These were human beings just like us, you know, struggling in a world that is often very complex. You know, sometimes the heroes that you think are these, they're not always saints.
Right.
And a lot of times, you know, the man that had slaves is ultimately the reason why we've ended slavery. And we need to be able to deal with these complexities, because that's just how the world is. We're never going to have this utopian world in which all oppressions are gone and all isms and all bigotry. These things we will have to face as well. By creating this kind of whitewashed picture of what the past should be and the series of oppressions leaves us deeply unprepared to face the challenges of our time in the future.
Is it the ease with which simplicity is absorbed by the human brain that makes this so successful? You know, he's just a racist, rather than, by the way, he also cured cancer, you know, but still he must be have murals taken down to him, things like that. Is it just, it's just easier, or is it laziness, a combination?
It's both. I mean, it was funny to me. It was like people were saying recently that we should, well, let's get rid of Columbus Day. We'll just call it Explorer's Day instead. So we don't want to offend anybody.
It's let's honor Dora.
Yeah, exactly. But you know what? The greatest explorer of the last 500 years was Christopher Columbus. That story needs to be told. And I think it is very easy. Look, you had this recent problem with this mural in San Francisco of George Washington, yeah, in which it depicted slavery and a dead Indian. It's funny because the mural was done by a leftist in the 30s.
Right, trying to show how horrible the country was.
And they couldn't even take that. They had to take that down because, oh, there were some people who were offended by this. Take it down. It's like, well, wait a minute. That was originally, it was supposed to be showing the opposite. So that shows where people are right now. It's that anything that offends, and of course everything offends, needs to be removed. It needs to be abolished.
Offended that you said that. But it's not, you know, we spent a lot of time talking about Christopher Columbus, talking about the founding fathers, but the revisionist history, the rewriting of history, is not just then. It's current. It's not current, but it's within people's lifetimes. And some of the most important events, one of the last chapters, the American century. That's not, you know, the 18th century that you're writing about there. It is a continual process. The one thing about the left that's much better than the right is they can multitask like crazy. That's the benefit of a hive mind. Everybody goes at it from every different direction. Talk about the bastardization of the 20th century.
Yeah, I mean, look, I think most Americans would still say that World War II was the good war, that we played the right role. And I do wonder, especially these people who turn America into this, you know, boogeyman of history of oppression, how is it that America played this critical war in this good war? You know, what were the qualities that made us a country so that we could stand as a bastion of freedom? And, of course, you have these revisionists that say, oh, the Soviet Union really won the war and things like that.
Yes.
And you get these kind of things, too. It's like if the Soviet Union won the war and there was no United States, we're simply replacing one tyranny, horrible tyranny, for another one.
Right.
I mean, it doesn't take much to see what's going on.
They wouldn't have stopped at Berlin.
No, they would not have stopped at Berlin. And it's not hard to see, especially today with modern communist China, what our world would be like with the Soviet Union at the middle of human affairs. It was the United States and not Nazi Germany, not the Soviet Union. And maybe today we'll say not communist China that's at the center of human affairs is an important one. And you didn't get that United States without this long history that came before, without the generations of patriots and ideas that made Americans what they are. Those people who fought in World War II, their grandfathers, many of these people today would just simply, oh, they're racist from another time. These are the people that destroyed evil. They destroyed Nazism. They destroyed the most anti-Semitic regime in human history. We should know those stories. We should teach those stories. We shouldn't just look at it like, oh, those people in the past are grandparents, bunch of racists, write them off. These are the people that ultimately made this free country we call the United States. It's worth understanding them at the very least and saying, you know, maybe they had some good things to say to us. Maybe these people sacrificed heroically so that we could live in a free country today. Maybe we should think about that instead of destroying their statues, instead of tearing them down and destroying them.
Thank God we didn't have Twitter back in World War II, or everybody, Audie Murphy would be, you know, history's greatest monster. Mention Ronald Reagan to a committed liberal today, and they still convulse into a Tourette's fit. The man has been dead for 20 years and been out of the White House for 30 years. The left holds a grudge. Who, in your estimation, as one of the experts wrote the book on this, is the one that will convulse a liberal into Tourette's? Not him. They're the worst. And Christopher Columbus being accepted because he's history's greatest monster, clearly. But in an actual United States history, who is the one that, if the left had one bullseye to put on the map of our history, what do they want to take out the most?
It's got to be the founders. I mean, I really think it's them. Because, of course, you look at the long history of the United States, what we are really does come down to what they did, what they started. And, of course, the cultural foundation of liberty that comes from them, I think that's the main – it's been very hard for them to attack the founders because they've been so universally admired and revered. So they start with the lower-hanging fruit. It's always easier to go for the lower-hanging fruit. You know, that's, I think, why, and to a certain extent, it was easy to kind of go after the Confederates and say, oh, by the way, Jefferson said some bad things too. But by the way, George Washington, maybe he's not so good either. They start with that low
Benjamin
fruit.
Franklin.
And Benjamin Franklin.
Slaves,
look, you can go one after another. Recently, Gandhi was canceled because they dug up some writings of Gandhi. So I think that's what it comes down to. It's been a tough challenge for them. In the past, I think the left has often co-opted the founders. You know, FDR had his second Bill of Rights and things like that. But the new left of today that kind of is that generation, you know, post-Howard Zinn, post-1960s, they have a very different ethos. They're attacking the very heart of what this country is. And I do hope that in my book, I explain what the heart of the country is and why it's ultimately good and worth preserving. It's worth defending. And it's easy to be proud of these things.
Couple last questions, Jarrett. When you sit down to write a book, you've done most of the research in your head, even though you still have to do the actual research. You have an idea of what you're going to put down on the page. In the course of your research, in the course of filling in those blanks, what surprised you the most? What did you learn? You sat there and you go, oh, wow, that's not what I expected.
I didn't expect the kind of the depth of the attacks on American history. I think that's what's so shocking to me. And maybe I shouldn't be surprised at this point. I mean, we've seen attacks that, I mean, the simple rapidity from the fact that they went from Confederates to Jefferson to even Abraham Lincoln. I mean, there was this one story I uncovered. University of Wisconsin has an Abraham Lincoln statue. There were students that were who were protesting there. And they are protesting various things. And one of them actually said, well, the reason we want to take down Lincoln is because he owned slaves. And I thought, well, that, I mean, that really is something. I mean, you wouldn't even be bothered by to look up, you know, who this guy was before you decided to go after Abraham Lincoln. Almost a no-brainer.
First of all, you should sue everybody who has ever called themselves a teacher and had you in their classroom because they did you a massive disservice.
Exactly. So, you know, I think it's the combination of the speed at which this movement has now gone in the last few years, and the number of figures who are now under attack is quite stunning. Also, frankly, a lot of the ignorance in some of these attacks as well. I mean, there isn't even any kind of sophisticated attack on history. It's just, well, it's a statue of some older-looking guy, must be bad, tear it down, blow it up, burn it. And maybe it shouldn't be surprising. Obviously, you know, revolutions like this sometimes go very quickly. But it is stunning. I mean, these were once universally admired figures in our history. The idea that you would take down, you know, a statue like that even 20 years ago would have been almost unthinkable.
If you have to Google who is on the statue to be offended by the statue, the problem is you. Last question for you, Jarrett. When somebody puts this book down after turning the last page, they're done with it. What do you want them to think?
I want them to feel pride in their country. I want them to feel pride in what this country is, what it's about the people. It's about the ideas and the people who ultimately built this country. And I want them to think, how can I take action myself? You know, in my conversations, in my school, I mean, with discussions with neighbors, to defend our country's history. And sometimes it's hard because there are a lot of people who make wild attacks, some of them based on ignorance and some more malicious. I want them to take the information from my book and have these discussions and not be afraid to defend your country's history. We have a lot to be proud of. Not everything in this country's history is something to be proud of, but most of it is. And there are a lot of great things, and you should be willing to do that. And I hope that I give you the information that you need to go out and make these arguments and make these defenses of a country that I'm sure most of your listeners are very much proud of.
And if they aren't, stop listening. Although there are a lot of foreigners who listen to it. I get the emails. You can keep listening. The only way the lies win is if people stop telling the truth. And the war on history, the conspiracy to rewrite America's past, is the truth. Jarrett, congratulations on the book. After we're closed here, I'm going to have you sign these books, and you can enter to win a signed copy of the book. You just email me, Derek@dailycaller.com. Let me know that you want to be entered, and you're not just telling me to buzz off. And you'll be entered if you have bought the book or if you're inspired to buy the book, if you send me a picture of you with the book, not in a Barnes & Noble, not in a bookstore, or a screen capture of your receipt, you'll be entered twice. It's just that easy. Jarrett, nice to meet you. Thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
Appreciate the conversation. Congratulations on the book. Go check it out. Subscribe to the Daily Caller podcast, all that good stuff. Share on social media. Have a great weekend and be back here on Monday. See you later.